We got an alternate, but she's not here today.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how you do that.
Doesn't bother me.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's recording.
Okay.
Your office.
What's that?
I am, thank you.
Okay, good. All right, I'd like to open the March 13th, 2019 Portsmouth Conservation Commission meeting. Just remind everybody to use their microphones. And first on the agenda is the approval of minutes or not approval of the minutes from February 13th. Did anyone have any corrections, additions?
I have a minor spelling. I don't know. It may be page 11. The Army Corps is C-O-R-P, not C-O-R-E.
I get it wrong every time.
Thank you.
Anything else? Seeing none, somebody like to make a motion?
So moved.
Motion to approve, seconded. Any further discussion? Ready for a vote? All in favor?
Abstain.
Okay. All right, just to kind of a point of order today, as you can see, we are 4 of 7. And when we get down to 4 of 7, we always give the applicant the choice to come to another meeting, and basically because with 4 of 7 to approve, you need 3 out of 4 votes. Just changes the percentages a little bit, but it's up to the applicant whether you want to postpone or go ahead. It's just a procedural thing that we have to do with the quorum of 4. 2 and 2 doesn't work, so it has to be 3-1. Okay. So first on the agenda here with conditional use permit applications is number 143 Whidden Street.
Plans, no?
Oh, plans, I don't know.
No, I don't think there's plans on there.
Okay, so you have your plans in front of you. John Chagnon from Ambit Engineering. With me is Ann Taylor, property owner. Mm-hmm. The Taylors purchased 43 Whidden Street coming up on 2 years ago, and they pull off of Whidden Street and park in a lawn surface area that has challenges this time of year, especially with freezing and thawing and mud and so on and so forth. So they would like to replace that surface with a porous driveway section. Mm-hmm. That's what the plan shows. So we submitted a package of information, including a listing of the criteria and conformance with the criteria for approval under Article 10 and 1750. The applicants have obtained a shoreland permit for the work, so that's been approved. They have a driveway permit. We agree with the staff memo as far as the proposal conforms to the ordinance, and really don't need to go into any more detail because I know you have a lot of things on your agenda. If there's any questions, I'd be glad to answer them, but we'd like to get your recommendation to the planning board for approval.
Very good. Thank you. Questions for the applicant? Barbara?
And I don't know if I actually read this or not, but at some point I thought I had read something about you would be capturing runoff
with the porous paved roofs? And then I think I read that it wasn't capturing any additional, it's just capturing what's going to land on the driveway.
Right, right. So it kind of mimics the grass that's there now.
So nothing else is flowing on?
Nothing else is flowing onto it that doesn't flow there now, and so nothing's flowing off that doesn't flow off.
I think it makes sense, and it's nice to use the porous. And I'm not sure exactly where the property lines are. And of course, you don't want a bush in your door when you open your door, but it'd be nice to maybe, just put some plantings around it or something. It just looks so barren. And that's really just an aside. That has nothing to do with the application. It's just be nice to try to capture some of the water and some shrubbery or something. If there was a, again, I don't know where the property boundaries
are. The property lines are on the drawing. It's very close to 53.
Yeah.
I think a foot most off of that structure next door. So we did leave some space that could be planted. That's a good point.
It would just help with water purification, if possible. Anyone else have questions for the applicant or comments?
How many cars can it fit?
They have two vehicles,
two.
So it's two routinely.
Two. Okay. Thank you.
It's kind of an awkward
pretty
arrangement
tight.
Because of
yeah.
The street is very narrow and there's parking, people mm-hmm. park on the street, and you kind of have to come in northeast of that pole that's there, so it's a little odd. Comparable to a horse and buggy arrangement.
Yeah. All right, anything else for the applicant?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Discussion?
I just want to say, I think, if it's not capturing anything additional than what's falling on it, I think this is definitely an improvement over having the runoff coming from the existing dirt area.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, I think it makes sense. Get the water into the ground and have a place to park. So ready for a vote?
I just didn't know if we wanted to add any in the maintenance plan, if we wanted to add anything about snow removal and sanding.
It wouldn't hurt. We can put in.
Well, I guess I would, for my information, how do you treat porous pavement in the winter with regard to sand? I presume they would need to shovel this area, John.
Snow blow it, most likely, mm-hmm. Yes.
I would think they would not be using chemicals on it for salt.
Correct. If you use sand on your porous pavement, you're just increasing your maintenance.
You're clogging it up.
I think they need to. It's flat. It's a flat area, so grade-wise, I don't think it presents a situation
with
traction.
Doesn't sand diminish the effectiveness of the porous pavement?
Correct.
Yes. Do you want to add something?
I think so. Just a point about the winter.
Winter maintenance.
Related maintenance.
And what would you suggest?
No sanding.
No. Okay, that's good. Does that make sense? Yeah. It just clogs
it's
up though.
It's
yeah,
obvious, but I like having
yeah.
it
yeah.
written down.
Okay.
Well, yeah, and I'm just assuming that the homeowner doesn't want to diminish
no.
or
right.
create problems
yeah.
for themselves further down the road. That's fine. Sure.
Okay, so motion to approve and seconded with the condition of no sand on winter maintenance. All right, ready for a vote? All in favor? Okay, there you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right.
Hungary is so much shorter than 428.
Okay, next on the agenda is conditional use permit application for 428 Route 1 bypass, and also we have a State Wetland Bureau permit application, so we'll deal with one and then immediately deal with the next.
So, hi, everybody. Thanks for coming today. I know we are all busy. I'm Rick Lundborn from Fuss and O'Neill, the engineer on the project. To my right is Brendan Walden of Gove Environmental Services. We're here to talk with you today about this, if you'd like. We have been before you a number of times, and we have addressed all the comments that were provided last time and made a lot of strides to address your concerns. So I don't need to give a presentation if you don't want one or feel you need one, and just have a conversation.
Let's have a conversation unless there's anything new that you would like to present.
Nope.
Okay, very good. So let's open it up for questions. Natalie?
In your hydrologic analysis, I'm assuming you increased the extreme precipitation estimates by 15%. Is that correct?
You mean 15% over the NRCC?
Yeah.
I haven't, but it's a massive, it's a pretty decent reduction across the board. So, and you would do that for pre and post.
Right.
So it would be on parity.
Do you guys need an AOT permit?
We do. So we'll be doing all of that.
There is a new requirement with a state AOT permit for projects in coastal communities that you increase the estimates by 15%. So just a heads up there. I have one other question.
Please go ahead.
I appreciate the additional details and information that you provided to address all of our concerns and questions at the last meeting, so thank you for that. I did have one question about the culvert removal. I saw in the notes that you're proposing to just cut the pipes essentially and fill them with cement.
Well, you would just the end to cap it, and then you would fill that over the part you'd pulled out, and then you'd flow fill the back or whatever to get it to a point that it's in beyond the bank top.
Mm-hmm.
And then if, you know, obviously as it goes out through the site, if it's a long pipe, they'll pull it out, but they're not going to leave a void. They're going to fill it with flow fill or cement at the end.
Okay.
What's flow fill?
It's like a really, the liquefied sand.
Oh.
And they just, it makes it so it goes right into the pipe that you're abandoning. And
yeah.
It fills it. Sometimes they'll mix a little cement into it, but not always.
Uh-huh.
It's just a sand slurry that goes in and then it dries out.
Okay, good.
And is that the preferred alternative to removing the structure in its entirety? Is that best practice?
In the case of this, where, you know, we're concerned about the bank,
right,
we felt that that was the best way to go, because you'd have the limited disturbance of pulling the end off or collapsing the end.
Okay.
And then filling it over, and then in the areas where we're doing invasive removals, removing the invasives, replanting and juting it to hold it while that those plants take place. But more, it was so we didn't open up a 3 or 4 foot wide trench through the bank.
That makes sense. Thank you.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Does that flow fill ever shift or?
Once it's dry, it's pretty much
it pretty much settles
fills
in
the void.
Okay, good. Okay, I don't have a question per se, but on page 8 of the stormwater management report, the stormwater flow rate results, the 10-year storm net change, I think that's supposed to be 13.86, not 0.60.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Was just looking at the numbers. Other questions for the applicant?
Steve.
I'm sorry, Barb.
I just wanted to check on page eight also. There is the erosion and sediment control. In the second paragraph, you mentioned hay bales, construction entrance. So I guess hay bales really aren't the preferred method at this point. More like a log of some sort.
Silsock log or erosion control mix berm log.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Which for this site would kind of make more sense too, because you do have sort of steep areas, especially where you're working around the disturbance on the bank.
Mm-hmm.
So I definitely would want that to be, I don't want to recommend what you should do, but at least check into it. And then I had, there's a lot of information here, which is what we asked for, which is great. And so I apologize if I ask a question that you already
you don't have to apologize.
Have in here. So on, I guess it's page L2.01.
Yeah, I'm going to have to have the plan.
Oh, yeah, I can open that for you.
It's on there.
You put the phone on there, so you should be able to get to it pretty quickly. What's it called?
It's the. No, it's the one on the left. W E Y.
Thanks.
Those would be towards the tail end of the.
Yeah, it's like
that part. Be down a ways. It'll be after all the civil stuff.
It's towards the end, right?
Yeah. It's like, I mean, there's like 100 pages, so.
I know, it's only going slowly. That's all right. Okay.
Okay.
Almost there. Here comes the landscaping plan. So you said it was
L2.01.
So, I think you have one more of these to go, and then
one more,
and then it's into the details. So you're talking about a detail sheet.
Detail sheet.
Yeah. Right. Restoration sequence moves. Yeah. I think that's it. I just need some notes.
Yep.
Can't read, but.
What you can't read.
Well.
I can tell you what it says.
What's the, what is your question? So is it the same question?
Number six. No, actually the question was the removal of everything. I know you probably got it somewhere else because this is just in the sequence notes, but all fill, including pavement, cinder blocks, cement, trash, buckets, couches, appliances, equipment, et cetera. So maybe it is referenced somewhere else in there. Are you
on the plan sheets we have? See, this is the same sequencing notes that we have on the note sheet, which is CN001, and we say on the civil plan sections where they're going to be doing the bulk of the earthwork, see, refer to those notes for this restoration sequence.
Okay.
So.
Does it say exactly what you are removing, kind of, or
well, it's
sort of general,
it's
like
general like that? It's the junk, pretty much. I mean, I don't want to have them not pick up something because it wasn't on the list.
Right.
So.
And I guess my question has to do with the discussion, and I guess there's been previous discussion even before your last meeting about taking out some of the pavement and the cinder blocks and cement. Some of that actually is going to be pretty disturbing. And I don't know, in addition to the fact that some of it has been there for a long time, and the Army Corps may have actually put some things in there. So I know we've had that discussion before, but you coming to this meeting?
I think there was a discussion of if the bottom had been cemented, and you had said you guys did an auger all the way down to the hill, right?
We went down like 3 feet in the center of the channel to check, and there's nothing there.
Okay.
So, I mean, I think the intention is to just take out the manhandleable debris that's not supposed to be there, that's obviously been deposited by abutters or just people not doing the right thing over the years, and leave things. Like, there's a couple of big pieces of, like, granite curb, it looks like, anyways. The granite slabs and things that are there, those would stay.
Those would stay.
One's going to move that, yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to clarify that, because that would definitely be the preference on that.
But, like, there are couches that are probably, I don't know, 2 inches stuck into the dirt, into the substrate.
And yeah.
Those kind of things aren't going to disturb the soil any more than removing the invasives.
Okay.
But we're not going to remove any of the vegetation. I know in the center of the channel, not too far from the bypass there, it's silted in a little and actually has vegetation growing over it. Little
not,
island.
Not going into the channel.
Good. Okay. That's what I thought. Just want to verbalize that. Yeah, please.
So then my other question is on number 9, clean topsoil will be added to the areas and remove materials. I'm assuming this is on the embankment. And create a smooth bank to be planted. So I don't know if I, visualize kind of this lack of just a smooth bank going down, or
it's in between the large plants that are to remain. You know, your the trees, the maples, the locusts, things like that aren't necessarily invasives. They're going to go in between those and pull out the knotweeds, multiflora rose, and
the
things like that.
The buckthorn and things that aren't supposed to be
there. So in those places where they do the removals, they'll have to smooth it out to replant it.
So I guess it would be nice to see one clarification here. Clean topsoil will be added to areas of removed materials only, if that's all right.
Mm-hmm.
Just because I could see, obviously, you're not going to be necessarily doing the work, and whoever reads this might.
You're worried about them putting soil across the whole.
Yeah,
bank.
And just leveling it off where there's nice little pits and mounds from, I know it's all invasives, but.
It'll just be where the work's done.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
You're very good.
Thanks.
Other questions?
Thank you.
Anything else for the applicant?
Well, I just comment that we really appreciate the detailed planting relative to the brook. I think that really fills in for us a visual of what's going to happen there in a really positive way. So thank you.
You're welcome. I'll let the
landscape
architect know.
I did notice a detail. It talks about a water conservation pond on L2.01.
There's two rain gardens over towards the very tail end of the plants that are in the buffer. The bases are pretty much out of the buffer, but they're in an area where PK Brown is right now, so that must be what he's referring to.
Oh.
So it's essentially a rain garden.
They're more industrial-sized ones. They're bioretention areas.
Yeah.
Same cross-sectional design, but they're on the larger scale than a residential rain garden.
Thank you.
That yard's been used for storage of
all kinds of stuff that shouldn't be there.
Just building materials and
there's a debris pile out back that they're actually going to remove. There's a couple piles of various loam and gravel materials. You know, that's all getting leveled off and taken away.
Do you anticipate any surprises in the removal of the buildings and the
I don't think so. I think they actually did a boring in the one of the bay garage bays to PK Brown, and they didn't find anything from an environmental standpoint.
Yeah.
That was the original. They did a phase one and a phase two environmental, and they didn't find anything of that scared anybody over there. There's a couple spots where they found, like there's some buried gas diesel tanks with the old diesel garage. And even that wasn't bad. There was like some trace oxidations that go with that on the tank, but nothing that once that's removed, it will all go away.
Yeah. So. Okay, very good. Still some thinking going on? Anything else? Bart?
Just one last question, which probably is also in here, is the invasive species removal and disposal of it following DOTs. Did you guys recommendations on that?
Where to dispose of them?
Yeah.
That we called out specifically where, but we certainly can.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would follow whatever DOT has specific recommendations on where to dispose of and how to dispose of what. I thought I saw it before when I looked through and I was like, I don't see it.
Oh.
Is it in there?
You know what? I bet you it is on the erosion, on one of the two erosion control sheets. There's large banks of notes, and there is a, as I recall, there's a discussion of invasive species and
yes, it's
not permitting them to be around. So it's probably in there. Those are the NHDES notes, though, so they may not be specific on disposal. Probably just says off-site in accordance with local, state, and federal regulations.
There's a go ahead, Marianne.
L2.01 has extensive notes, a restoration sequence notes, and it talks about removal and guidance by staff from GES. Mm-hmm. I don't see a particular comment about the standards, the Department of Environmental standards, or
we can certainly add it.
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Did you have anything to add to that, Natalie?
There is another note, and I'm not sure if this is what we were looking for on CD 510. There's an invasive species note that says the contractor shall take steps to prevent the spread of invasive plant, insect, and fungal species by meeting the requirements and intent of RSA 430, Section 53, and AGR 3800 relative to invasive species. I'm not familiar with either of those statutes.
Oh, there it is.
But
it,
that might be well.
Is that what you're looking for, Barb?
Yeah, thank you.
So it is there, just in.
Those are our standard erosion control notes that we've gotten over the years working with AOT. So that's one of their standards.
Thank you.
Okay. Looks like we're covered. Anything else of concern, questions?
I don't know if Barbara.
No, it looks like she's good.
I'm good. Thank you. It's too small a group.
All right. So, and no other questions? Are we ready for a motion?
I guess we're down to two. Motion to approve.
So, motion to approve.
Just for my second.
Seconded. Any discussion?
I would just comment. Again, I appreciate the extra detail, particularly since our focus was the brook and that connection.
Mm-hmm.
That's the purview of the commission, and you were extremely helpful in providing all the extra details so that we get the visual that. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Okay, anything else? Ready for a vote? All in favor? Very good.
But just to clarify, you guys, it was just recommendations, not stipulations, right?
Right. I think, that was for the conditional use permit, and now let's deal with the State Wetland Bureau permit application. I don't think there's any new information. I always ask. There never is. And so open it up for questions from the commissioners. Seeing none, looking for a motion for State Wetland Bureau permit application for 428 Route 1 bypass.
So moved.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Seconded. Any discussion?
I would just reiterate the same requests that we made, at least some to clarify the clarification ones.
Okay. In terms of what was being removed from the brook.
What was removed
and what was being spreaded, right?
Oh, right.
Oh, where blooms being spread. Absolutely. And again, we can take the note about the standards of removal disposal and add those to the restoration notes so they're in both places.
Okay, very good. So, ready for a vote? All in favor? Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, very good. Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Next on the agenda is conditional use permit application for 11 Sagamore Grove. And 11 Sagamore Grove. Hi. I was confused. I thought that we had the minimum impact, and then I thought
it was. For this one?
Yeah. Then I thought it was state, but.
It was, but that's already signed off. So this is just a conditional use.
Okay, very good.
My name is William Pingree. I live at 11 Sagamore Grove. I'm also the owner applicant. I feel like I'm an amateur among professionals, so I'm not quite sure. If you want me to give a presentation or.
Or just to describe the project for us and what you're hoping to do.
Well, I don't know if any of you are familiar with that property, but for years it's been used and abused, neglected, used as a temporary gravel pit. For a long time, it was the site of some type of bait shop that was let run down and decay. It was used as a dump for fishing equipment. And it was also the staging area for when they rebuilt the Sagamore Grove Bridge.
Oh.
I recently built a house there and went obviously through a lot of permitting and whatnot, and a lot of the problems that were there were cured by me building the house and doing the lot preparation and whatnot. But one of the features of the land was that there are remnants of old gravel pits with sharp edges, not really deep, you know, 2 to 3 to 4 feet deep. Those are all eliminated on my lot with the exception of one that is just into the 100-foot buffer zone, but it's also very close to where my deck and porch are, and it's quite hazardous. 15 or 20 feet from my deck. I've fallen down there a couple times. It just drops off. You can see where it's obviously been dug out. And what I'm asking for is to be able to fill that back in roughly to the original terrain. And to do that, I need an access path, which is pretty much there. It may need a rock here or there taken out. Uh-huh. And the access would not only be for to do that project, but to remove old timber that's fallen down, deliver cordwood, emergency vehicles. When the project is finished, I envision it as back to natural state. I don't plan to mow it. I would like to plant it with some type of low-growing combination of grass, clover, wildflowers. As they say, it'll eventually fill in with leaves and whatnot, and it'll be pretty much the way the rest of the property is on that side of the on that side of my house.
Okay.
So if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Very good, thank you. So open up the questions from commissioners.
Yeah, I have one.
Yeah.
Mr. Pingree, when I look at this picture, is this your house?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
And those columns are where my deck and porch are.
Yeah.
And just to the easterly of that is where that, it really drops off almost like off of this table in that one corner.
There's quite a piece of granite up there.
Yep.
Okay.
Just explain to us, do you have an estimate from a contractor about how much fill?
I haven't got an estimate from a contractor, but I figured out roughly how many cubic yards of fill. I don't know if I have it immediately.
On plan, here. Can you put it on your plan?
Okay.
Here. Isn't that what this is?
I didn't. Oh yeah, 66 cubic yards.
Okay.
That's a rough estimate because it's very irregular, mm-hmm. and I don't want to build it up higher than what's there because there's a ridge between that low area and the creek.
Yeah.
So that's your answer.
Yeah. If you build it up higher, it'll have the potential for eroding right
exactly.
over.
Exactly.
Yeah. With the depression there on the map, it leveling off would give you a space that wouldn't be hazardous.
Correct.
Other questions from commissioners?
In this photograph, you have some X's
yes.
marking where some trees are slated to be removed.
Yes.
Is that to accommodate the fill?
Well, you would kill the trees anyway if you filled in, and they're all less than 6 inches in diameter. I think I wouldn't even need, I could take those trees down anyway, I think, mm-hmm. but
yeah,
it doesn't make sense to fill around them because they would die.
Sure. What kind of trees are there, just out of curiosity?
I think there's like, they're mostly maple and one pine.
Well, I think, you know, just by observation, that's what Yankee people call that land, spiny. And they obviously excavated, however they got it out, but they took a hunk of that rock as gravel at some point. And so you've got, even down below, you have these rock outcroppings. It's a bit of a challenge as to what would grow there. You know, it sort of struggles.
Well, nothing's going to grow where the granite is, which is
like the rest of
the lot. There's a lot of granite there. But the area that I'm going to fill in would have enough soil to be able to grow enough to keep it from moving.
Yeah.
I'm
mistaken. Those are oak trees.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have a question about these structures. Are these on your property?
Well, they were. And the reason I put them there is that building was actually into the 100-foot buffer zone. And it's amazing that the city's let it stay there for so many years. It's been there as long as I can remember. I did have to get a permit to tear it down and post a poster on it, but it's gone now. But there was a lot of trash associated with that as well.
So that's no longer there?
Correct.
That's good.
That is definitely good.
And there, we're working on trying to get some good plant lists, but I'm sure there's plant lists available for low, like you said, some shrubs or something you would.
I actually don't want to plant any shrubs. All I want to do is plant some type of grasses. One of the staff members suggested a mix of flowers and whatnot. Uh-huh. I have this enviro lawn, which.
Okay.
Which,
very good.
There's so much stuff growing up there. Yeah. It's every different kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, no, that's fine. That's good.
I wanted to do native plants, but there really isn't much as far as native grasses that would really be suitable, I don't think. This seemed to be, from my reading, to be more suitable for this piece of land than trying to pick an ancient native grass.
Very good. Any other questions for the applicant? Barbara, you.
I guess this is just to clarify. You had said you kind of wanted to go back to a pretty natural state afterwards, too. And I thought I had read that somewhere in here, but I can't find it. Is it somewhere in the application?
I think right on the maybe on the first page of the wetlands permit.
Loam planted with native grasses and maintained in a natural state. Yes, that's where I read it. Sorry, yep. I apologize. Question for Peter.
Okay, Peter.
Peter, did you go out to the site?
Yeah.
And so is there this, like, a nice buffer? It looks like from the photos there's a nice buffer. Not so relevant to this project, but.
Below the project, yeah. It's interesting. This is, it actually drains back towards the house rather than towards the water where he is. Hmm. But as you go over the edge, further down towards the water, there's a decent buffer. I don't know.
There's actually another one of these old pits that is not on my land that, if you get a really torrential rain, you'll see a puddle in that lower pit, which isn't on my property, but it's gone in a day. You
know. It's not very accessible to get down there, so it'll just be natural, I would imagine.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Okay, seeing none, are we ready for a motion? All of our motion makers aren't here.
I'll move that we approve conditional use permit for 11 Sagamore Grove.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All right. Ready for a vote? All in favor?
Thank you very much.
All right, good luck. Take care of that land.
Okay.
All right, so next on the agenda, we're into the State Wetland Bureau permit applications, and we're to be for 13 Salter Street.
Good afternoon. My name is Zachary Taylor with Title Ecological Consultants, and I'm here representing, along with Jack Teague from MSC Engineering, 13 Salter Street, the New Hampshire Wetlands Standard Dredge and Fill application for the Shoreline Stabilization Project. To give you kind of a summary of the project, project at 13 Salter Street is the, if you're going over the little bridge or the sluiceway for going to South Mill Pond. If you're looking up Pickering's Creek, it's the property right on the right. First one on the right, right after the city's little slice of parcel there along the bridge abutment. And this parcel is, along Pickering's Creek, obviously a commercial, like historically commercially developed parcel. The shorelines have been developed for, hundreds of years at this point. And this section has a combination of existing stabilization that has occurred over the years without any real hard and fast dates as far as when it was installed, but it's a combination of old seawall, old timber bulkhead, and riprap along the shore. So the project, the owners of the parcel have seen over the years of owning the parcel an acceleration of the backyard essentially washing away into Pickering's Creek. So the intent is to go in there and stabilize that section of shoreline, very similar to the rest of Pickering's Creek shoreline there, with hard armament. It is there isn't really a foot of the creek that isn't stabilized with either seawall or riprap. So the project, this has been going on for quite some time, did extensive amount of preliminary work with both DES and also speaking with Portsmouth Planning to be able to come up with a game plan that works. It's a little unique as there is a section of that, the very corner, if you're looking, standing on that parcel, looking at Pickering's Creek. So if you're facing north or kind of looking to your left, the city owns that the little corner parcel there. So we worked extensively to be able to come up with an agreement with the city to be able to extend the stabilization and connect with the existing stabilization, big, large rock, granite rock stabilization that was done by the city at some point in time. That way, so there's a continuous stabilization along that shore. So worked with them to be able to, have an agreement to do that accordingly. Worked with Dave Price at DES to come up with a game plan that made sense on their end. And that's the plan that we have in front of you guys today for a combination of the riprapping. What we determined was the minimum needed of the shoreline. It's probably ranging from a 16 foot to 20 foot long embankment down to the base of the creek, the lowest point of the creek, and working to make a design that would be the least amount of impact needed. We determined that we could do essentially the top portion of the slope, essentially an 8 foot face, where we would build in the riprap toe and build up from there, starting with first putting in the existing erosion control methods, both around the disturbed area or temporary disturbance area shown on the plan, and then along the top of the riprap to be installed, so that we're not creating siltation to the waterway, but in a scheduled plan of installation, only removing enough stone that would allow the contractor to be able to stabilize that section in the course of a working tide cycle, so that we're not leaving open exposed soil in the process, and then building that section back up with a combination of the existing stone and then any new imported stone needed to make up the difference. So and working with DES and coming up with a game plan, one of the things that we agreed is to be removing any live stone, so stone that has existing seaweed that's growing on it, separate that from other stone, and then incorporating that back into the structure accordingly down the road. So as far as the kind of the impact, it's about 168 average lineal feet of shoreline there, and what we're proposing is around 1,830 square feet of permanent impact, and 2,997 of temporary impact. But to note, 1,693 square feet of that permanent impact is over the existing stabilization area. So there's really about only 140 square feet of additional impact, permanent impact from what's kind of in the area existing. So obviously be happy to answer any, you know, specific questions and concerns of the CONCOM, but that's kind of a general overview of the project.
Okay, very good. Thank you. I was struck, and maybe I don't get the perspective, but from the pictures to the plan, like the picture, site condition photograph 5.3, it shows it from across the creek, and then the bottom view is like right along it, and that's the property immediately to the right. Is that correct? I'm looking at the, you can see the old pilings in there.
Yep.
And then the silt fence. So it looks like the house there is like 10 feet away from the silt fence, but on the plan, it must be, I know it's in the buffer there. And is that, I mean, it looks like it's all new construction.
So if you're looking at,
I'm looking at that.
Oh,
sorry. Oh, that's awful.
Okay. So that photo at the bottom of 5.3, that is the abutting property, lot 10229. That's their boathouse. So that's on Erickson and Levy Pruin, tax map 10229. Are we talking about the same thing? Or were you talking about the...
Well, I'm looking at the
top photo says view looking south from South Mill Street.
So I assume that was like they're looking across Green Creek.
This is an older photo. The house has since been finished. So you can see the foundation work is going in there.
And how much room is between the house and the shore?
I think it was built to be outside the primary building setback, or whatever that was, the 50 feet.
50 feet?
About 50 feet back.
I guess the bottom view really confused me. It looks like it's still under construction. It looks like it's like right on top of the shoreline. But
From that photo, it's deceiving from a perspective standpoint.
Can't see the house in that, really, I don't think.
Yeah, and what are the plans for the area above the riprap and the reconstruction of the shore?
So there was
the plan shows a gravel driveway. Is that still an active gravel driveway between the house and the brook?
So there the gravel driveway was approved and would remain, and then there is the it'll return to. The disturbed area will be stabilized, seeded, and hayed, and et cetera, in order to bring back the lawn that was there, and then the planting schedule that was originally approved. And I apologize, I don't have the date, but that went through the last time they were through getting a permit for the actual house. That was the agreed upon planting schedule, so we're just put that back into the plan.
Okay. So the photograph's just an older photograph, and that's what's throwing me off.
Yeah, and I apologize, it's been a process to get to where we are. So those are older photographs.
Yeah, I was just really confused. It looks like there's absolutely, on the photos, there's no buffer or anything happening there. And so after the construction of the sill and the riprap, then the plantings will be done.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And they haven't as of today because it was still a construction
site. Yeah. Yeah, good. Okay.
Natalie?
Okay, good. Our living shoreline expert.
Do you guys have a sense of just how much erosion the property has experienced within the last few years, say, like any metrics? Has it been measured at all?
You can see from the original they set the silt fence originally when they started the construction back, I forget when the original project started opening up, and just over that time, the silt back, is the erosion is, 3, 4, 5 feet in some areas beyond the silt fence. So it's actively eroding. So it's, I don't know when they started the original project, but it was something that, what spurred them was, it seemed to be something that was getting worse. If nothing's done, it's just going to keep eating away into the yard.
I'm just trying to get a sense of, what's actually causing it. Are you pretty confident that it's the flow of water moving through there that's causing the erosion behind the silt fence?
Yeah.
And so by water, do you mean the water from the brook?
Yeah.
Or water from the land?
Well, it could be either, I guess, if it's coming off of the the property, or if it's from
coming
the brook
from
itself.
The water.
It could be either.
Do you have a sense of that in terms of the erosional force? What's driving it?
Yeah, I mean, it appears from the way that the erosion's happening, it's happening on higher tides and kind of, any sort of storm surge that's coming in. So
you don't see the rivets. You don't see the small erosion channels going down the slope. You just see them at the water line.
Okay.
Can I keep going?
Please.
So you mentioned there's some existing stabilization. You mentioned there's remnants of an old seawall, timber bulkhead, obviously the riprap, that's pretty apparent from the pictures. Is there actually an existing wall there now today, or is the wall that is being proposed essentially a new wall?
No, that wall is no longer there.
Okay.
So
this gray area on the map is proposed new construction.
Right.
You did mention, I appreciated you pointing this out, that you have an agreement with the city to be able to tie in, I guess, what would be the western end of the wall with the city's stabilization. Is the height going to be consistent throughout on that end? Or is there going to be a difference in height between the proposed new wall and the existing stabilization? I only ask that because I saw that you are accounting for sea level rise, which I am very appreciative of. But if there's a difference in height, then the water can just wrap right around it and eventually probably undermine the wall from the opposite end. And so if there is going to be a tie end on either end, then the height needs to be consistent. I didn't know if you had discussed that or if there's plans
I
for that.
I wasn't in that discussion. It does look lower, a little bit lower here on that end, but I wasn't in that general discussion.
The design of the riprap was to tie, kind of top to top to the existing riprap.
That's with the elevation of this.
The wall.
Of the wall itself.
Of the existing wall.
Right, so the wall ending, Corey was part of the original design. He felt that based off the elevation, that was the best ending point for the wall because it was tying into the slope at a point where it would protect. Because the original conversation was, should we just end the whole system at the property line and have it kind of clean cut and not try to build something on city property? And in the extensive process of going over it, felt that Corey, the principal at MSC, felt it was well worth the process to have a consistent design that would tie in effectively to the city's parcel so that the project, all the work he put into the project, isn't undermined. So that was his intent, was to tie it in. I don't have the specific elevation where and how it's tying in, but that was the whole, we spent months trying to get that through, and it was all because we wanted to tie into that embankment as it kind of curls up there by the abutment.
Right.
That was my recollection being on the site, is that it kind of, the slope kind of goes up there, and if you didn't put it there, then the problem you're thinking about would happen. That's why they wanted.
Yeah, I guess I'm just having a hard time visualizing.
It's hard to visualize the shape.
Is there going to be a corner of the wall that, or is it just going to meet the grade?
It turns into a steep riprap slope on the city piece at that point. So without that wall, you'd kind of lose out, you'd have that opening that you're thinking about. This way, I think it covers that.
Closes that opening.
What about?
Closes that gap, yeah.
So that's at the western end of the wall. What about at the eastern end? How does that tie into the adjacent property?
Currently, there the property to the eastern side is stone wall, and then a failed section of stone wall right in front of the boathouse. Mm-hmm. I believe the owners of that parcel, in speaking with them and getting the sign off for being within the 20-foot setback to this, their intent is to be able to stabilize that as well accordingly, just because the that's what they've got an older kind of just dry stack stone wall that is going to need to be replaced anyway. So I think the intent was to kind of leave that open to allow for if there's water that's overflowing, or kind of future design to be able to tie things in. Mm-hmm. But we don't, they're not ready to move forward, so we're just kind of worrying about this section right now.
Okay, that's a little concerning because there's no guarantee that a continuous structure would be built. I have more questions, but
please,
if anybody else has anything.
Mary Ann?
No,
well, please go ahead.
I'm curious if you can talk a little bit more about your analysis of alternatives. And I read that you had evaluated potentially regrading the slope back to maybe implement a more, living shorelines-esque or vegetative approach to stabilizing the shoreline. And I'm curious if you can just speak to why you think it might not be feasible to regrade to 3-to-1, given the 1-to-1 and 2-to-1 slopes in certain areas. It does seem from the plans like there might be room to do that. So I'm just curious what your thought process was there.
I guess at this point, the concern is that there is, there's the creek's, say, 350 feet long. Mm-hmm. And out of all the shoreline, there isn't, there literally isn't a foot of it that isn't currently hard armor. So I would have a concern, the distance from the house being what it is, like, so we had to go back another 10 feet and 15 feet into the yard, sacrifice that to be able to install some sort of more kind of living shoreline sort of stabilization methodology, which I think is unproven at this point up here in New Hampshire. We've got an active experiment in town that we don't have hard and fast results on yet that it's actually working at. I would be, in that instance, they actually tried removing the hard armament on around it to give it a better shot here. And this is essentially going to be, it's the end of the creek, and it's directly across. It's almost entirely across from a seawall on the other side of the creek, and it's directly next to a seawall, and it's pinched in against hard armament and a sluiceway from South Mill Pond. So I think the concern is that you go through this experiment to get it to work, and you find it doesn't work, and then you're back to square one to be able to put some sort of hard armament piece. I'm a full supporter of trying to get it to work, to not put hard armament in when it's not necessary, but I think in this particular instance, it is the entire creek is what it is, and most of the parcels don't have the, even have the opportunity to go, to knock down the seawall and have enough room to do something that would work. So it's not something where over time the city can, you know, push in a direction to be able to eventually do the whole creek as that. It is that South Mill, unless you sacrifice South Mill Street, you know, or, and you have Sanders rip down their building, you're not going to, you know, that, that seawall is always going to be across from that creek, or across from this parcel. So I just think it's one of those instances where there isn't much to be done in this particular situation, given it's kind of pinned into the corner here in an area where the rest of the shoreline is always going to be hard armament.
Since we're next down too, you know, this is where the Pickering Creek necks down, so you can get more.
I'm sorry, what, say that again?
It's where Pickering Creek kind of necks down as it goes through.
Necks down, you mean it narrows?
Narrows down.
Okay.
Before it goes under the bridge. And
just for curiosity's sake, how old is this house?
The original house, I mean, it's got a, I don't know, I'm sorry, but it's old.
It's so. A big white one.
Yeah.
That's.
The, right. But they rebuilt, they essentially rebuilt it.
I remember, yeah. Because they were in front of us on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why I was confused by the photo. But, yeah, we are trying to figure it out here, and we have a lot of people interested in, and I don't think we're suggesting site suitability for living shorelines, but we want to really investigate any opportunity that's there, and the hard armament, it just, I don't know, just, it just, like I said, it's already hard armored, but it's a tough one. You know, we're trying to figure it out here and trying to figure out what's going to work, because obviously this isn't going to be the only application in front of us for this type of thing with sea level rise and other conditions, just the storm's getting worse, so. Where that's where the concern's coming from, is trying to really make sure we're thinking through this and what's a good plan.
I have two concerns. You were giving us some numbers about the amount of impact and the fact that, relatively speaking, there's just a small percentage of it that is new.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is that towards the house or towards the creek?
It's towards,
or is it a particular area?
It is towards the house, and it's just because instead of, it's just kind of straight lining the shore a little bit more. So that was, if you look at the proposed conditions plan, you can see in kind of the light gray,
yeah,
rocky rubble, that's the existing, you know, kind of established sort of riprap. So you can see the hatched line, that is the proposed riprap, and except for that the very tiny little slice of a corner on the right-hand side, it is all within that the existing riprap. So we just kind of straight-lined it the shore to, you know, to make for kind of ease of construction, et cetera. So any encroachment this way was that 100 and I forget what I said, just short of 200 square feet was more from kind of straightening things out.
Okay. One more.
Go ahead.
When you were over there doing the assessment on this, did you look at, or were you able to put any age on the work that had previously been done that's eroding? Does it have this silt thing behind it? Doesn't have any of that.
No. I've heard some stories to try to, you know, figure out when this stuff was installed. I mean, there is some really old timber bulkhead that was there, and I think was actually built over at some point in time. That's exposed. That you can see the pilings are exposed and exposing from as the erosion continues to happen. And then, you know, there's, I think a lot of this area may have or could have been fill at some point in time, and we don't know when that stone was installed, but we're estimating it kind of predates the 1962 time frame when permits were even required.
Okay, thank you.
if I may, Steve here.
Yeah, please.
We certainly took this into account, the whole process of the alternatives analysis and figuring out if this was going to be, was there a way to not show up with a hard armament project in front of you guys? And
yeah.
I think kind of what I went over before was what we finally concluded was it's just, it's not ideal in the direction that we're trying to get things to head as far as protecting what we have for New Hampshire coastline here. But in this, it's almost an isolated incident in the city's entirety of their shoreline and what's to be protected and protected in such a way that's preparing for an eventual sea level rise. I think that we're with this project, we're kind of we're really not creating any cumulative impact from the sense of setting any precedent or anything like that, because it's one of those things where you put this on another. Let me get to the point here. There's very few other sections of shoreline in the city of Portsmouth where you could be like outright, this hard armament will work, and it really isn't creating any additional impact because it's like the missing piece, or it's rebuilding something that's already there. If you plug this in another section of shoreline, you would be opening it up for, oh well, if this guy or gal put this riprap project in, then the person next door could do it, and the person next door could do it, and all of a sudden you're heading in the opposite direction of what we're trying to do with the shoreline in the area, kind of moving away from the hard armament. So that was our mentality around it. And that's why we have that project in front of you, this project in front of you.
Yep, appreciate that. It's a tough one. The wall itself, I think, I think it's just human nature to think that the walls are going to be so much better. And I'm not sure we have any other options here, but I could see people just wanting a wall because they want a wall. Where they have opportunity. So like that's kind of you're right. It is kind of in the back of my mind anyways about, setting a precedent, and it's like, oh, well, you let so-and-so do it, and I want that nice clean-cut wall to separate me from the water as well. But I get the constraints of the site and the narrowness of the channel there. And I appreciate the saving that living rock. How are you going to store the living rock and where? Because it won't live if it's out of the water.
I mean, that there's a lot of room, shore, waterward of the construction. So the idea would be pick it and set it out in front of, so it's still in the tidal waterway. Essentially, it's just temporary storage.
And DES was okay with that?
Yeah, that was a discussion with Dave. They preferred the effort to save it than.
Yeah. Well, we've had a similar effort not too far from there with the salt marsh when they reconstructed the road and moved the salt marsh plants to a safe place and then brought them back and put them in once the road was shored up and stabilized.
So. We don't know how successful it all will be, but it's a healthy seaweed.
Yeah, it needs that tidal cycle every day.
Yeah,
or it's not going to. Not going to survive. Questions? Any other questions? Yes, Natalie.
How far away from the wall would you say that the proposed tree plantings are going to be? Mm. And is there any potential for interference of the root systems with the wall?
It looks like it's
10 feet away.
And if there's a preference, I think we're certainly open to suggestions.
Yeah, I think it's just going to be what's going to survive there.
Yeah.
I mean, I would imagine some salt spray. And then I don't know how the waves will react to the wall and if it'll make it worse or diminish the spray. But that's something I think the landowner is going to have to be sensitive to and monitor and be willing to try something else if the oaks don't survive, or sugar maples, red oak, sugar maple, red oak, sugar maple. But.
Yeah, I guess I just don't have a sense of how much circumference the roots of those trees take up.
Yeah. Well, it
but if you're going to put a wall in there, I wouldn't
want
the trees
to undermine. It looks like they're far enough away that they wouldn't be the big part of the root. It would probably just be the...
Yeah.
But it does, they basically go to the drip line, so...
Yeah, the drip line of the tree. So as the tree gets bigger, the root...
You might want to move them back a little bit, but...
Yeah, it depends on what size you want to keep them at.
Yeah,
they might not just not grow very big.
Yeah.
And they're not going to get salt water there. It's up pretty high from the salt, I think, but they will eventually, the wall...
Yeah, I was just wondering about salt spray.
Oh.
And then if the wall would make that better or worse, I don't know. Natalie?
You mentioned a non-woven geotextile filter fabric to be laid underneath the riprap. What's that made out of?
Plastic fiber.
Is there anything that's not made out of plastic that you could use instead?
There are things. The idea is that it doesn't deteriorate. That's the problem, is because then you don't have to do quite as much maintenance to it. We could look at an alternative to that. I don't have one off the top of my head. I know that, like, they use coconut matting and stuff like that when they're doing erosion control protection at different areas. And you're underneath the rock and stuff. The whole idea is that if you put it down once, you don't have to pick it up again. Or if you put down something that deteriorates, then you're having to disturb that area again to replace it. But no, there's a way, you know, you kind of weigh it, which way is the best way. I'm not saying which way is the best way, but.
So and I'll let the engineer correct me if I'm wrong on this, but that's, you know, the filter fabrics, like the, you know, it's really the backbone of the whole structure.
Sure.
So that's what's preventing the erosion from happening, and then you're building your layers up from that. So you've got your compacted gravel there, and then you've got your larger armor stone on top of it. To Jack's point, if you put something that has a 10-year lifespan, then you're going back through the, you know, either they don't do anything and then you run into erosion happens for X number amount of years, and then they finally go back to the process to do it again, versus putting in a woven fabric that, you know, you put it in and it's there, and you don't have to go rip the system back up to put it back down. So that's what you're trying to protect that, because that's what's really protecting the shore, is that fabric.
I think my preference would be to avoid plastic-based geotextiles if at all possible, or at least investigate that alternative.
We're happy to see what we can come up with for alternatives that would produce a reasonable lifespan.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions?
The commissioner's suggestion, if this goes forward, then how do we keep track, or do we, of what actually goes in there?
We still have to go through New Hampshire DES and Army Corps of Engineers, and what we end up with is an approval. That approval needs to be, you know, recorded, and then we have to submit for a building permit, get approval, and execute the project based off of the approved plans. So, we can't just get through here and start building the project. So the city's planning department, code enforcement, is going to be the ones that, they're going to make sure we do the work that we say we're going to do. And that's our intent, and that's my intent, is to get something approved that works and then have it done the way that it's approved. So.
And I mean, he can report back to me what he finds for an option. I mean, I guess my question would be, if there's no alternative to geotextile fabric made out of polypropylene or whatever the plastic is, it seems to me a better solution to have that than to have nothing, and it's held in place by the stone. It's not like it's free-floating plastic. I guess the only situation where you'd lose it is a massive storm that tears the wall out, but in this location, you're not going to get that wave energy. So it's pretty unlikely you're going to lose it.
Yeah.
But
I think it's the concern is just that, you know, plastic does degrade over time. So, and it's, you know, introducing another foreign material into the environment. And while it is probably longer lasting than some of the alternatives, it's not fail safe either.
No. So. Yeah. No, I agree. I agree. It's nice to keep the plastics out if you can, but I guess the alternative is erosion underneath the stone if you don't put anything there. So it'd be nice if you could find an alternative that isn't polypropylene or plastic or whatever.
I think what I would suggest is, as the motion goes forward, is that we ask them to evaluate the non-plastic option with some information about its longevity.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's where you really, I think you need to know, is this, how viable is the alternative in terms of the property owner's expense. And
sure. The
second point is, the more you go in there, the more disruptive you are.
Yeah.
So the more you have to go back to repair and restore,
mm-hmm.
the more challenging that is to the shoreline. And you've got this extensive report from U.S. Fish and Wildlife about all of the habitat involvement. And so you want to be really careful that in order to do one thing here, you don't create this other thing over there. And that would be something, though, that I think that if we can just find a few words to put that in as we approve it. So we want them to explore and evaluate
alternatives,
options and effectiveness, including the longevity. I don't know if longevity is the right word.
Mm-hmm.
Of the product.
Lifespan.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, and then, I mean, if they do find a good one, then it's something you could recommend in the future. So I think it's worth the effort.
And we're happy to report not only just back to the CONCOM, but anything that you put in your recommendation, the
It'll
DES can't
forward.
Just be like, oh, I didn't see that. We've got to respond to every recommendation or proposal from the CONCOM. So before we could get an approval, we have to address that concern or recommendation.
Okay. Appreciate that. I think that would be a good thing to find out if there are.
What are the options? What is the effectiveness?
$10 million for a carbon fiber.
Yeah, that's
carbon fiber. Yeah.
I don't know what the other options are going to be, but it'd be interesting to at least explore it a little bit and see if there are some.
Yep.
Well, it's part of as you go forward. These aren't going to be the only projects.
Mm.
Yeah.
So everybody learns something. It's an expensive way to learn something, but you learn something as you go forward.
Okay. Any other questions, Barbara?
How high is the wall going to be compared to the seawall across that's in front of the fish market?
The elevation is at 9, and then the elevation on the South Mill Street is somewhere around 7.5, I think, to the top of the granite.
Oh, on the street there?
Yep.
Yeah, and that's pretty much, I've seen the water right there.
Yep.
And the floodplain is 9.
And that was kind of our concern. If
we
just matched it, then what are we really doing? So
making a swimming pool.
Right. So we
swimming.
Yeah. Try to find that healthy balance between building something that's not going to let any water through and, you know, something that protects but reduces aesthetic and other impacts. So.
Barbara?
So the elevation or the grade or behind this, the wall that you're putting in is going to be at, that's going to be at the level it is now? Or is that going to
match existing?
In? You're not going to be filling anything else in there. And I had another question, which I don't know how relevant this is, but was that area ever stabilized after the construction was put in? Because I've seen that silt fence there since you guys have been doing, they've been doing the construction on the house, so.
I can't answer that. I was brought in for this project here, so I don't know. I mean, I apologize. I permitted the dock way back when, but other than that, I haven't been a part of any of the shoreline projects, so I can't speak to the actual.
You mean, did they bring material in?
Did they stabilize it? Because
it's not very stable.
No, but I get the feeling it's never been even, there's been no attempt to do anything since the construction has been going on. And when you look at the photo, it's obvious that that silt fence has been there. That's an old photo. The construction's happening. That same silt fence is there. It's like nothing has been done other than the original disturbance in the silt fence.
That's why they're here.
Sorry?
I think that's why they're here.
Right. But to do it. But it just seems like that area was disturbed. There was construction materials all in front of the house. I mean, it was sort of not just the fact that there's a, you're on the creek and there's, you know, whatever, the water coming up from the creek is causing problems, but it seems like there was no attempt at all to circumvent that from happening other than this extreme situation, which is the more permanent, probably, and I can understand that, but it's a little frustrating, I think, from my end to see that, to walk by that every day and see it a mess. And then now, it's like, okay, everything's falling apart, but it just seems some of it's self-created. So it's a little bit where I'm coming from.
I mean, I think and I can't speak for the owners, but, you know, realistically, this project probably should have been submitted around the same time that the rest of the project was being done, so that they could have been addressed at the same time. But I think they're trying to live, they're more worried about living in a house than, you know, the shoreline taking out the, you know, eroding in the process. So, but that's all kind of guessing. I don't know about that.
Okay, any other questions for the applicant? Seeing none, ready for a motion?
I move that we approve the state wetlands permit application for 13 Salter Street with a recommendation that the applicant explore a non-plastic option to the web that's proposed, including the effectiveness, the cost, and the prospective lifespan.
Okay. So, motion to approve with condition? Looking for a second?
I will second for discussion.
Okay, so seconded, so discussion.
Can I ask a question of
Peter? Yeah, you can ask Peter a question.
So I don't want to put you on the spot, but we didn't get a recommendation for this?
It's a state wetland permit application.
Right. So
I don't typically do that for the state.
Right, but you've participated in things up till now, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So.
Well, I went out and looked at it. I looked at it the same way you guys are looking at it in terms of the living shoreline piece, but I don't really see it in the, given the location, I don't really see there's any viable alternative. The elevation of the property and the house aren't high enough to, I don't think, to have a living shoreline work, especially given the hardened nature of that creek. But
even like a hybrid with the riprap and then regrading above the riprap and constructing an enhanced, like a really robust buffer.
I don't know. I mean, I guess. I don't know. Anything's possible, I suppose. Yeah. Like the way I looked at it.
Sorry, go ahead.
The way I looked at it was it's all hardened around it, so it's like a loose tooth, and you kind of want to, the water's going to want to get to that area when it doesn't, can't get to the other areas. But yeah, I don't want to see our whole shoreline hardened, yet at the same time, this isn't an area that everything's hardened. So I don't know what, you know, what we'd achieve by getting a, maybe we'd get some habitat, but we also could undermine the house or create an issue for the road or drainage in that area. What I don't want to see is a bunch of erosion happen on a project that doesn't work. Mm-hmm. So to me, it seemed like it's a hardened shoreline already. We're trying to shore it up rather than change it to something different versus a project where you could create a living shoreline.
It is a new wall, though.
Right, but it's riprap below it. So the whole thing is getting washed on riprap, not the wall. The wall is the top to keep it from eroding in the front. So
yeah,
that's how I looked at it. I don't know. I mean, it's not an easy one, and I think
yeah,
it's going to take a while before everything becomes to get everything to a living shoreline and try to protect the properties up above it.
Well, but I don't think we're trying to get everything to a living shoreline, but trying to get living shorelines where they will work, and we're trying to figure that
right.
out.
And I'm not enough of an expert on living shorelines. I'm sure there is some theoretical way to make it work.
Yeah.
I don't necessarily see it in this location, and I would be worried about undermining the house and the foundation by going so far back on the property that you'd change the shoreline. The shoreline location would have to change if you did a shoreline, living shoreline, and then would the neighbors have to do it at some point, or would they be able to leave it the way it is, which would provide them the same protection they have, which isn't much right now.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Marianne, you?
Yeah, I guess I have a procedural question. Our chairman alluded to this at the beginning of the meeting because we have a four-person commission mm-hmm. today.
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds like this proposal is controversial. The applicant, if it comes out 2-2, then they lose, right?
They don't get a favorable recommendation to the state, right?
Okay.
Would you
like me to withdraw my motion?
No, let's don't do that yet. Let's talk about it some more, because I think this is a really tough thing, and it's something that we're going to be struggling more and more with as we move in the future. Mm-hmm. And as much as I don't like it and don't like the wall, I don't know what alternatives we have here at the site. And
I mean, I guess
Just in terms of you look at the map and all the other houses around there. I don't know. I'm worried both ways. You know, setting a precedent for a wall.
Yeah.
But
this is an historic house. This whole corner.
This whole area.
Yeah.
Is.
And they have. I attended recently. Just it's a brief segue. Attended recently a program that was put on by Discover Portsmouth, and the first topic was sea level rise relative to the South End and Strawberry Bank. And
mm-hmm.
the challenges are just enormous.
Mm-hmm.
And they're enormous from the rising tides, but they're also enormous because of the groundwater levels rising, which are having significant structural effects on these old buildings. So that's another factor because this house is where it is now.
Yeah, this isn't going to help going to change the groundwater.
Yeah.
But it.
So, as much as I don't like hardware, I would support this with the recommendation that I made in my motion.
Yeah, I would do the same. It's just, I don't know what else to do other than to vote to approve and in this location. But then I have concerns for future, but those, I think a lot of those concerns aren't answerable right now. I don't know whether what other alternative we have, but my biggest worry is the wall's going to be kind of attractive, and I think people are going to want another, attractive wall somewhere else. But I get the gap in here and the loose tooth, on that shore, and so I know it's tough. Sure, Zach, go ahead.
So to Peter's point as well is that if we do grade back this into the parcel, then what we end up doing is we've got, two kind of pinch points right on the corner. It's not like we've got kind of open shoreline with nothing on it on either side.
Yeah.
You've literally got a boathouse right in front of the parcel on the eastern side, like, you know, feet away from where the stabilization needs to happen. So you've got to, you'd end up having to build this kind of U into the property, like build a cove into the property to make something that would work, because you run into the exact same issue. And
yeah,
it might be just as complicated over on the side, on the city's parcel along along the street and close to the start of that the bridge there. So we're just kind of, it's one of those things that you know, to be frank, I told the owners that this, you know, this was going to be a difficult project, because I know very well the direction that things are heading, and the city of Portsmouth being kind of a leader in what we're trying to do here with the shoreline in the city and the state, that I accepted it because I just knew that there wasn't a whole lot that could be done with this particular parcel, and that it's really, you know, from a the standpoint of creating additional impact from other people wanting it, it's so specific and so unique that it's hard for anybody to build a case that, oh, just because the Nicole Gregg Revocable Trust built it, that we're going to be able to build it.
Well, that's something we're going to have to deal with a little bit, and but I appreciate that. I guess I just wish there was a better alternative to a wall, but I don't know what it is. I don't know that we have any options. Barb?
Yeah, I mean, that's the biggest problem I have. One of the biggest problems I have is setting a precedent, because how do we? We just have to look at each property individually, but can we do that?
Well,
once we've got this huge wall, and they're like, oh, well, you guys permitted that wall.
We do that pretty well, I think.
Yeah.
Overall, I know that can be a big concern, and it is a little bit in the back of my mind, but we do look at parcel by parcel or each project by project. And
I think one point to that, Barbara, to set this property aside, is that it is a riprap shoreline right now. So a lot of this work is maintaining the riprap that hasn't been maintained in front of that wall.
Yeah.
The wall is kind of the cap, but the water isn't hitting the wall. The water is hitting the riprap. And so the first thing that's going to happen is that limestone seaweed is going to move its way up the riprap. So I guess I don't see a huge change with this project. It's not ideal from a living shoreline standpoint, for sure, but I guess I see it as, we're not making it worse. Are we making it better? I don't know. I mean, I think we're trying to stabilize it if we approve it.
Yeah.
But you're right. It's going to be something that we have to deal with going forward, and what's the way to do that?
And the wall's the thing I have that biggest problem with.
Mm-hmm. Anything?
There's nothing. You just mentioned that the adjacent property has like a stone wall.
Yeah. So I actually made this up. I kind of forgot to hand it out, but it was just from the map geo and kind of crude highlighting the shoreline. So the yellow is the existing seawall, and orange reddish color is, you know, kind of the riprap area. So it kind of just gives you a highlight of what the creek looks like right now.
Okay, again, the yellow is
wall.
Vertical stone wall.
Yeah. And then the orange is riprap.
So the whole thing has got a lot of
hardware
on it.
Yeah, there's literally not a foot of it that isn't.
Yeah.
I think there's very few places in the city's jurisdiction where you can say that.
I think a question or a comment. I mean, just a lot of this, anytime you stand there, I mean, you spent a ton of time there, all real high tides, all of that on the south side is underwater. All the walls and all the riprap. So, it's just going to, we can say there's all these walls and riprap, but it's just going to get worse, I guess.
But what's the alternative? I mean,
I know.
Erosion is the problem we're trying to solve. Erosion of the shore.
So we're stuck between a riprap wall and a stone wall. We're in a tough place. Rock in a harder place, yeah. So I don't know what else to do. And like I said, I think we're going to get faced with this more and more. And it's good to be really clear about what we, but I don't know what else to do here but approve. Honestly, just given the location in the houses. So, Snickers time. Ready for a vote? It won't be any less painful in 5 minutes. Ready? Ready for a vote? All in favor? Opposed? Okay.
Sorry, I appreciate the time. Thank you, everybody. Okay.
Now, wait a moment. I just have a question. So does our motion stop here? So even the recommendation that we explore doesn't go forward?
In terms of the exploration?
Well, they can see the minutes of the meeting,
But then it doesn't, it takes away the initiative for them to do that piece of work.
Right, the recommendation fails.
Thank you.
The motion fails.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have a work session for 230 Commerce Way. And they want to put in.
Where would be a good spot to set?
Right over here, Jim.
Set up this
right over here. It's usually where people put it.
From where to where?
I'll put it right
we'll see.
In front of Patrick.
Yeah.
I'll put it right in front of Patrick. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So we're
you don't even provide a tripod in
here. We used to.
We have to bring that home.
Hey,
budget.
Hey, this kind of works. Play with it a little bit here. It just needs to, there's a little bit of pushing together. There. If nobody hits it, we're going to get it. All right. I'm Jim Gove, Gove Environmental Services. With me is Bob Ulig from Havison Design Partnership and Patrick Crimmins from Tie and Bond. And I actually have, if you folks don't have in front of you, I do have more of these.
Mr. Gove,
yes.
Be attentive to the microphone, please, because we might have audience.
Thank
you.
Folks
should
like,
be, is that what you submitted?
It is what we
they
submitted.
They should have all
I,
that.
Do you have these?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Great. All right. In case you need more, glad to provide it. Or if you want something to sketch on or whatever. We're here for the Kane Company, and I just want to kind of set the stage as to why we're talking about this.
Excuse me, sir. What are we talking about, Jim?
We're talking about invasive species removal, and we're talking about creation of a trail system. So that's what we're talking about. And can I take this and move over there? Okay.
Oh, okay. You have to take the table with it.
Okay. And do I press it to make sure?
It takes a minute to come on.
Okay.
Should turn green, I think.
It's on.
Sounds like it's working.
So from the standpoint of where we're talking about here, first off, this is Market Street. This is Portsmouth Boulevard here. Commerce is over here. And this is actually 230 Commerce in this location.
Oh, this building right here is the market basket. And the situation is that the Kane Company has come to recognize that as they continue to build in this area, a lot of folks who are moving in are interested in some outside recreation. They essentially have already put in a yoga area over on outside yoga area on another one of those parcels. And it's actually a marketing thing to basically get people interested in these office places by offering them ability to do some outside recreation. So we're looking at this area of woodland that lies in through here, that is between the Commerce and Portsmouth Boulevard and Market Street. This particular plan shows, and it's an infrared aerial photo, so that's why it's red. And it shows the LIDAR topography, so you can see the topo that's out there. And it also shows in green the wetland delineation that we did. And so what we have here is an area of woodland that has some drainage systems coming into it from here and here. It actually drains in this direction behind the market basket. And this is a wooded wetland in through here. And in the center of this is more of an emergent marshy area. So, and you have in your packets all the pictures of the various places around that we took. You see a lot of the invasive species. You see a lot of the trash that's been thrown in here. There's a homeless encampment that was in place over in here. If you want to know the refrigerator location, it's right there. So what the Kane Company would like to pursue is, first off, removal of the invasive species. They'd like to, and that throughout. So it was not an area, what they don't want to go on, they don't want to, you know, cut tons of trees or anything like that. They want to actually go in with a landscape crew by hand and do invasive species removal in this area, both mainly the shrubs that you see through here. The second thing that they'd like to do is create a walking trail in this area. Now, there's actually no sidewalk along this Portsmouth Boulevard. And it's also difficult to actually get over to the market basket. And one of the things that we know is that people like to, from here, there's a market basket, Panera, and we know that folks, you know, like to get over to the Panera for their lunches, but they drive. And so the thought is that if we could create a walking trail system around here, and perhaps we could bridge over this channel through here to provide an access over to the market basket and the Panera and the other facilities there. So we kind of create a more of a park-like situation through here. And so that is what we'd like to have some input on from you folks. We'd like to be able to, and you know, when we talk about plans coming in, we know this is going to be a conditional use plan, so we expect to do that. And if we actually have any structures or the trail system, if we cross any of the wetland areas, we know we're going to be doing a dredge and fill, so that's we understand that. But, you know, what we would like to do is have some input from the commission early on, both from the standpoint of the invasive species removal and also either the trail network or what you'd like to see in a trail system in this area. And Bob has actually brought along some samples of some things he's done to be able to actually talk about what we might consider in this area. So that's really, I would like it to be like, rather than me just talking all the time, I'd really like to have a conversation with the commission as to what you might like to see here.
Okay, very good.
Are there any structures on that parcel now, Jim?
No. Well, unless you talk about culverts, but no, like, buildings in here. Okay.
Yeah. How many acres is it?
Oh, it's like around 3 acres, I'd say, about that. Yeah.
Three, yeah.
And we had in front of us years ago.
Yeah.
Proposed uses in there, and we voted no. And it's a really nice forested area. I mean, I did go look, and there is a lot of invasives, but it is full of trash. A market basket, the blowover from there, and then the homeless camp, which of course we have all over the city, is kind of a problem.
Yeah, I remember being back there, but yeah. There's also a significant amount of wildlife, an interesting bird population.
Yeah, there's a big raptor nest in one of the pines.
It was a really interesting corner, and it was just the trash and the debris. From the plastic bags and other stuff.
Yeah.
The invasives are also, they're not limited to understory. There's a lot of invasive vines that are growing up and impacting the health of the trees in that area as well.
Yeah.
And you know, the concept is if we do this and we create, you know, a walking trail through it as well as removing invasives, that this then becomes something that the cane company will maintain. In other words, it's not something where, it looks good this year, but 2 years from now, it's all going to be full of trash again. I mean, the concept is that they do want this to look good. They do want this to be a nice, I mean, they'd like to have people drive in and say, gee, what a nice looking area that is, because it is an entrance for them, for their buildings that they have down here. So that is really what. And we just like to have, you know, some input from the commission before we, mm-hmm. you know, start any kind of design or any kind of, you know, so.
Can you point out where the ownership is for the cane company?
Yeah, well, the cane company, there's several parcels here. So we have one parcel that's right here. And then there's a ownership, a market basket over here. However, we know, we've been talking to the market basket folks, and they would, from what we understand, is they would be interested in doing something here as well.
So the trail could go on that part as well?
Yes, okay. It could. And then this is also owned by Kane, so the trail can come as far up as into here and back around. So it's whether it's a you know, walking round trail, whether there's any cross things, you know, that's kind of what we'd like to have.
What are your thoughts about the trail being made of?
Do you want to talk about trail being made of stuff?
Going. I'll just show you a couple images.
Yeah.
Should I be Monty Hall for this?
Yeah.
So just to go through a few images that we brought together. So, you know, one approach could be where it's adjacent to the road. It may want to be something that's more stabilized. So it may want to be, you know, bituminous concrete. But then when it gets more within the wetlands area, we showed something that was more granular, whether that be a stone dust or a reinforced kind of granular surface, something.
And how wide are you thinking?
I don't know. We really hadn't gone down that road. I don't know that we imagine it being bike path and so forth, more of a kind of pedestrian width path, so maybe 6 to 8 feet, something to that effect versus a 10 to 20.
I guess my feeling would be more pedestrian walking path and not try to get into bike and make it too wide. One of the things I really love about that parcel is those big mature trees, and I'd hate to see any of those big mature trees come down. Mm-hmm. I'd also hate to see them get snuffed out by bittersweet.
Mm-hmm. Right, which is what's happening.
Which is, you see that happening around.
And yes, ma'am. Practically speaking, it's a seasonal trail. The trails would be seasonal because when the snow comes, you know, unless you cross-country ski them, they're not going to be used. I'm just thinking impact, you know.
Yeah.
Unless the company wants to maintain it year-round for people to be able to access the market.
Right, or there may be some portions of it that are year-round, some portions of it.
Yeah.
You know, the circumferential maybe, but if there's a bridge crossing or something.
No.
Yes, ma'am.
Jim mentioned that there is no sidewalk on one side of this. Is that the Portsmouth Boulevard area?
Correct. I think there's a sidewalk on one side, on the residential side.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, there's no...
There's a sidewalk on the residential side?
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's nothing on this side over here.
Yeah.
That's so, yeah. And the thought would, I mean, I don't know. I'm just speaking out loud, but I kind of, and this is just what I envisioned, but I, you know, could be wrong. This is a ridge right through here. So in other words, you have the parking lot, and you come up to the big trees, and the big trees are right through here, and then you drop down. And so one of the thoughts I had was, so that if you wanted to walk along the edge, we'd actually put the trail below the ridge. In other words, down more along this edge, right through here, so that you know, you wouldn't necessarily be just walking along the top of a ridge and look out on a beautiful parking lot. Instead, you know, you'd kind of have a little bit a nicer experience coming along through here. And then perhaps it would just go along the edge of this, and then you could cut down across around this way. And where this crossing might be, could be in here, it narrows down. This whole wetland, it narrows down and drains out in this way. And this is a fairly deep channel. But it would not be that difficult to put in, you know, a 6 foot wide pedestrian walkway to get over there. And then the question.
Jim, the one other thing we were talking about is the idea that it not just be, you know, the same experience all the way around, but there may be, you know, opportunities where, for example, you know, you have an overlook or something that comes a little bit into the wetland, so that you're kind of more, you know, immersed in it than just kind of the same perspective right at the perimeter of it. You know, there could be places where you get further in and you come back out. So it's, you know, it's as much of an experience as it is just kind of you know, a walking path around the edge as one possibility. So we had just shown a variety of different kind of, you know, trail surfaces, a couple different options for bridges, one that's more structured, one that's a little bit more kind of informal, and then a variety of decking surfaces, one that's more an open grate system.
That's the extreme bridge.
Yes, that's
for
right.
The extreme outdoor enthusiasts.
And there may be both, you know.
Yeah.
And then so, you know, open grading system, more of a traditional deck system with an edge condition, and then kind of an overlook, you know, where there's a place to stop out of the walking path and such. And then we also thought that it may be interesting to provide some, you know, signage in there if it becomes part of a bigger trail network. If there's you know, some interpretive elements worth noting about the wetland, et cetera. So just a variety of kind of images, just a
and you know, that marsh area. I mean, it's hard to see it now, but if in fact we did have like maybe a short little walkway just to overlook the marsh, would be kind of nice, because it is a nice little marsh in the center of it, but you really never get to see it because you're trying to look through all the buckthorn and the rugosa rose and everything else that's in there. And and if you try to get in there, you don't really care by the time you get too far in there, because you're already torn to shreds and bleeding. So, you know, it's kind of like, you know.
So, Barb, go ahead.
I just had a question, because in your letter you referred to a visit that you did, a site walk maybe with...
Yeah, I just walked around with Steve for a couple of minutes, yeah.
So I don't know if you could give us some background on that, since we weren't part of that.
Just Jim called me up and we met out there to kind of look and talk about the idea and to see what was in the regulations and so like I went back and checked on the regs, and if you look on... 10-1016 permitted uses. It says that any use that does not involve erection or construction of any structure or impervious surface. So that would be something to take in. And then but it specifically says, examples of uses include forestry and tree farming, wildlife refuges, parks, and recreational use.
And nature trails, if you look on the next page.
Yeah, and nature trails on page, next page. But
I think they'd still need a permit for the bridges, but the trail itself might not need a permit, depending on what they made the surface out of.
Yeah, and I guess my feeling on the trail itself, I guess I'd like to go narrower in stone dust and not yeah. like, that would be my idea. I mean, I love the idea of people being able to walk around it. I really love those trees. And every time I go to Market Basket and park along that edge of the building, I look long, it just makes me sad to look into that area because it's so degraded with the plastic and the trash. And I think, you know, one way to prevent that is to have people using it. But we just walked around the site and looked at it and talked about what the options were.
Talked about the options.
Yeah, and what the ordinance has in it and...
Yeah, I mean, I would be happy to have the commission go take another look if you want to go out there en masse and take a look at it. It's fine with us. It's just that, you know, we're trying to, like, we want to be able to bring something back to you that, you know, that you can feel good about. Okay, that's the bottom line. I want to be able to bring something back that you can look at and you say, hey, that makes sense. Tweak this here, tweak this there. Yeah. But you know, we want to be able to have, you know, something that at the end of the day, everybody feels good about doing.
Marianne.
Yeah, when I look at your schematic here, the green line is the wetland buffer.
Yeah.
Okay.
The wetland itself.
That's the wetland. That's the wetland.
Yeah,
that's
the wetland. That defines the wetland.
Right.
And what are all the white lines?
Whoops.
Terrain.
Sorry. Yes, that's topography, okay. And we took that.
And the yellow
that,
line is.
Let's see.
Property bound.
The property bound.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of setback because of the roadways, right?
Right. 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 Okay. Right.
Thank you.
Yes, and yeah, and that topo is right off LIDAR. So in other words, it's not. I mean, it's as accurate as LIDAR can be. Okay, and
what are
visually,
those spot doors? Are they 2 foot?
2 footers. Yeah, and okay. You know, but they look accurate to me. In other words, if you walk out there and you take a look at the topography, it looks, you know, where it shows steep, looks steep, where it shows. Not steep. It's not steep. So I think it's not half bad.
Steve, as the rather Jim, as the natural resource person, when we look at this water area and we look at the roadways that we've created around it, what do you think, way back, that the natural course would have been to this fairly significant stream?
I actually, well,
I'm sure the roadways probably had something to do with it, but
the difficulty is, here's my thought, okay?
Well,
I think that stream was under here someplace, because this is a straight line channel that comes right out through here. That's clearly been dug, and that carries it down to the larger marsh system. Over to the west, and so I think that this collection, I do think that perhaps there's been enhancements of a runoff because you've got impervious surface coming in on this channel, and you've got impervious surface coming on this channel. You still have also impervious surfaces from markets that are coming on this channel in here, but I also think that this stream that probably was in the middle, because you know when you do get into this area, you know it's muck. I mean, it's fairly deep muck. So you know that historically, this is not a created wetland system. The middle of this was historically wet. And I just think that if you take a look and you see where the channel was eventually going, I think at one point it was underneath Market Basket here. That's where I think it was.
Because I was curious about the land out there, the pond that is the Heritage Hill condominiums, that impoundment, they have a dam up there, or big culverts up off Maplewood. that's right down the street from what you're talking about.
Right.
That whole wet area.
On the other side of Market.
Yeah.
You think that culvert?
But it is on the same side as Market Basket.
I'd have to look at the, you look at the drainage through there, Patrick?
Well, it's not this parcel, but.
We actually had looked at that, what, 10 years ago when we were first back before the board. Steve had referenced, we were actually looking at putting a pad out here, and so we were looking at further improvements. It was more so out in the wetland complex, the stream, and the large wet area that's kind of like down this way. So we studied that whole watershed area, and I think that you're right. I think
that culvert comes under Market into that area,
that's
right?
That's correct, yeah. I think we studied that whole watershed area as part of that exercise, and that is included.
Yeah, there is a connectivity.
Yes.
And yeah, okay, thank you.
And then there's on the other side of Market, like when you're going into Home Depot, which is just down through here, there's those little isolated wetlands back in there that are surrounded by construction as well. Barbara, do you?
Yeah, I guess my one question, I have some comments, but would be if you were to do the trail, and I mean, you sort of couch this as a restoration project, and by removing the invasive species, would there be invasive species? Is a plan to remove them of the whole parcel, no matter where the trail goes, even if you're just on the outside?
No, because we recognize that a narrow little removal of invasive species isn't going to do much or anything for this parcel. No, as Steve and I talked about, you know, we don't envision, like, you know, John Brown coming in there with a Brontosaurus. We don't plan on spraying anything to kill it. This is going to be like, you know, a hefty landscape crew going in there and working for perhaps a week, 2 weeks to really do this job, and then there has to be maintenance afterwards, because we're talking about hand removal. We aren't talking about, like, you know, bringing in or even a backhoe or something like that to dig up stuff. We're talking about essentially cutting it down and then maintaining it. So yes, it would be across the whole parcel. Yeah.
And then follow up is, I still have comments, but I have another question about lighting, whether or not you guys would be looking at lighting at all for this.
It's pretty.
It's lit around the thing. Yeah. It's more behind the Market Basket, the crossing of the Market Basket area.
Well, that's one argument for keeping the trail to the outer edges.
What would you like to see?
I would like to see, what Peter just said. I would like to see no lighting, but I would like to see.
Keep the trail to the outer edges.
Keep the trail to the outer edges. I'm not at all interested in you guys going into the wetlands or even for viewing the wetlands, because we are, I'm a bit of a bird person, and I know that as soon as you do that, you're going to disrupt the habitat for the birds. In addition to that, I for dogs, I mean, how is you going to keep an eye on the dogs with this, keep dogs out of there, or keep dogs on leash or whatever? Because people, as soon as you have a trail, people are going to go out there with their dogs.
And I think it's interesting, in your photos, you have all these pictures of people who pick up after their dog and then leave the pets behind.
It was unbelievable. I was shocked when all of a sudden I see all these blue bags hanging from. I said,
but I think the irony is, well, it also demonstrates that it's already being used by people with their pets.
Right.
Yeah. There's an extensive walking network that kind of connects here all the way through the back of Osprey Landing into Spinnaker Point that people walk through regularly, whether or not it's
on the
structured
trail
or whatever. Yeah.
Trail in the woods already.
Yeah, I mean, it's like an abandoned road that loops.
Where's that come
there.
Off of?
You mean the end of Portsmouth Boulevard or in this area?
It's the end of Portsmouth Boulevard, so people do kind of use this. I'm not surprised.
This boulevard stops down here. It's got some, but then it loops back around. Yeah, I've seen people walking over in there.
Yeah, a lot of people walk in there.
Right.
Yeah.
So it loops back around to Osprey Landing.
Yeah.
And Spinnaker Point.
And Spinnaker.
For walking anyway, not driving.
Well.
So the point of this is to say what you would, what would be agreeable to you, or what it would take to be agreeable with it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it would take to be agreeable.
Yeah.
There's so little oasis is left.
Yeah.
And you see the wildlife take advantage of them, and as soon as you start getting people in there, you're gonna take that away from them, because it's just going to be too stressful. And the other part of it that I would want to see, if you guys are going to go in and remove the invasive species, is and on this whole lot, would be a surveyed plan exactly shows what you're going to remove and how you're going to remove it, and where it is.
I think that's going to be impossible. I'll tell you that invasive species are throughout the entire thing, and so for me to say, okay, well, we have a clump of bittersweet over here, and we have this over there. I mean, we're talking. This is literally. The entire thing is covered with invasive species. So, I mean, I think it would be an impossible task. I mean, we've got like a whole bunch of rugosa rose here. No, it's not in clumps. It's everywhere.
Well, I guess then, when we next see you, if you go forward with it, and I think there's merit. I also agree with Natalie and Barbara that the dog thing. You might want to come in with whoever you hire that's going to do the project to come in with a real plan of what, just identify that to the extent that you can the stuff that's out there and what the procedures and according to what guidelines they're going to be harvested and disposed of.
Okay.
And then there has to be some continuing follow-up because it's the birds and everybody else that continues to generate the stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're willing to make the effort to at least begin, I think that's a good idea.
Okay.
Yeah. Natalie?
Well, I guess that kind of begs the question of what's going to be left, since there is such a pervasive invasive species problem on this parcel. Like, what's it going to look like once you take that all out? Are you going to compromise the bird habitat? Is restoration going to be needed in order to make up for that loss in vegetation, albeit invasive? So that's, I think, maybe a question that we would want to see an answer to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because then it gets you into what would you plant that resists?
Right.
But actually, if the company is willing to make the investment in the first step, it wants to minimize its continuing maintenance of this area.
Oh, sure.
Well, and then also, if it had wildlife value, you know, to do plantings with wildlife value to replace the loss of the... Because when we tried to go up that ridge, and we didn't get to the top because it was just literally tearing us to shreds with the thorns.
Yeah.
But in some ways, that's a good protective habitat for some of the birds. But I think that's a good point about replacing, what's left and what we replace it with that has wildlife value. Because probably it seems like birds are probably using it more than anything else other than the homeless people.
Yeah, if we don't remove, if we don't replace and place cover over what is removed, something else will just come in and establish itself.
Yeah. Right.
This isn't particular to the natural resource of the parcel, but Kane & Company is going to assume some responsibility for the personal security of people out there. And that's why I would also think that if you keep the trails to the perimeter and don't create too many of these, it's an issue.
Well, I wonder, I think that is something to think about.
It's there, it's on their plate. You create an attractive spot, a destination, and a kind of a random population out that way, too.
Yeah, and even though it's not, I don't know how it's not enforceable, but definitely a lot of signage, kind of determining what you have expectations of people doing there and not doing there, and like disposing of the pet waste and keeping dogs on leashes and you know, the litter and things like that, I think is going to need.
Having receptacles for the pet waste would be super helpful.
I was actually thinking that on a lot of the trails, like I walk on over in Exeter, there are a lot of receptacles for the folks who have the pet waste, so they don't end up just, oh, walking along and then flipping them off into the trees or something like that. So, yeah, I think so.
I just have a question, maybe a comment. Is one of the things that I think about is the people that live over in Osprey and Spinnaker are going to be interested in a shortcut. So is there opportunity for them to come out of Osprey? And right now, they have to go all the way down Portsmouth Boulevard, all the way to Market Street to get to Market Basket. If the destination is Market Basket and they come out of Osprey, which I think shows up on that, maybe it's the other plan. Is that that plan? Yeah, there's Osprey. So will they have an opportunity to do a shortcut over to Market Basket? And I guess that was more for these guys to weigh in too, but I don't know what you had thought.
Well, I had thought that I wanted to make this circumferential type of walk
all the way around.
All the way around. And I wanted to have like a little bridge right here. So that if somebody did come out of Osprey, they could just hop on the trail and walk this way and then pop on the bridge and go over there.
Yeah, no, I think it'd be a great opportunity, but I don't know how these guys feel about that. Yeah. That'd be good to respond to, because I think that would be pretty heavily trafficked for the people that live over there, because probably a lot of them walk to Market Basket.
Mm-hmm. I guess my only thing about the shortcut through there is the times I've parked on the end of Market Basket, you know, along that strip, it's kind of funny feeling back in there. I wonder if there's more of I'm searching for words, but obviously is it more problematic to have a shortcut through there, or just by opening it up, make it a safer place to be?
Right. I don't know. That's why I brought it up.
Yeah.
Because I know that would be something people would be interested in, for sure. But is it a good thing or a bad thing? I don't know. But it's something that, obviously, with the bridge idea, it would open that up. I think it would be, I like the idea of bringing people to open spaces, if we can protect them the way we want to. But so I think it would probably, it could help that. But it's, like Marianne said, the liability is on Kane, to some degree, and Market Basket if something happens. But I think where I see homeless people is where people don't go. So if that's, you know, just homeless, but problems. But so if people are using it as a regular path, it might improve the situation.
For those of us who've been in Portsmouth for years and years, and we remember the challenges at Pierce Island, once we increased public presence, it discouraged a lot of the antisocial behavior that would focus there. So there's the balance, but I also think that every parcel doesn't necessarily need a highway to it because of the nature of it, so we want to be pretty careful.
Well, and I like what you said, Barb, in terms of signage and stewardship of the area. And I'd like to think that people that are in those offices would really appreciate being able to get out. And there's a lot of places where I would love to do this kind of stuff in Portsmouth, like right by the hospital with Pine Island. Mm-hmm. It's another spot, other than the freeway noise from 95. It's a beautiful spot that you think someone coming out of the hospital just for a half-hour walk would absolutely benefit from. So I like that idea to be able to utilize, but also the idea of the stewardship of it and taking care of it and maintaining the habitat and pointing out that it has those values. That's just something that I think is really important. I don't know whether we can pull it off here or not, but I just think that the people in those offices would really love the idea of being able to get a little sunshine and fresh air and get outside for a half hour at lunch.
And the thing is, I think that the majority of the we aren't going to have like a bunch of invasive species down in this really wet area. I mean, it's primarily cattails anyway. And so I'm not going to go in and cut down cattails. So you know, I just think that this central area, to me, where I see the invasive species are the rims around us. You know, it's the areas where you'd want to have the trail is where we're having the worst invasive species in there, because they are not necessarily deep into the wetlands. It's more along the lines of it's that transition from upland to wetland. That's where we seem to see
tons of stuff out there that's just tears in pieces, so.
Do you have any time frame on when the owner wants to initiate this?
You know, we were kind of told, hey, what would be the first step as to how to proceed on this? Because I think they're interested in doing something this year. I think they're interested in doing something, whether this spring or the summertime. And so I, you know, we were told, well, how would you want to proceed? And I said, and Bob and Patrick agreed that, well, first things first, we need to go here and have a little work session here with the commission before we put pen to paper and come up with something that, because we want to take your thoughts and comments and put that in. So I don't know whether we could come back in a month to do this or 2 months to do this. It's kind of
in the world of invasives removal, it'd be nice to do it while the plants are dormant.
Right.
But that's probably overly optimistic,
right.
Given that we're going to transition to spring before too long. But anyway.
I can't see us getting out there. No, we're going to have early spring anyway. Can't you see all the snow just going?
Maybe Friday, Jim.
No.
Well, thank you. It's an
interesting
idea.
I like to do a site
idea.
Visit, though, for sure.
Oh, site visit. Yeah, let's do one.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely.
Because that would give a good feel, too. We just poked on that one edge.
Yeah. No, I'd love
to. Yeah, you get a feel for what's possible, what's not possible.
Yeah.
Yeah, so whatever you folks would love to do it, we'd be happy to accommodate. So whether you want to set it now or whether you want to think about it.
Let's do a doodle.
Okay, yeah.
So what we usually do is send out a doodle to doodle poll. So
yep.
Get everybody's dates.
Great.
And then see what works.
Great.
Yeah.
Or
and
do it like a regular site.
And we're missing half our crew anyway, so
yeah.
Get them on the poll.
Yep. Okay.
Because I know that you know Allison and I have some good comments about
yeah.
invasives and habitat as well. So.
Right. That'd be good. Yeah. Yeah, you're right, because we don't have enough people here, really, to
Yeah, you get more feedback.
Yeah. That'd be great.
Yeah.
We'd love it. We'd love to have a sidewalk out there. Yeah.
Those of us who were out there, I don't know, 7 or 8 years ago, we were looking in the back, and we actually, as a commission, wrote to Market Basket and said, would you please do some of the policing for the back of that property?
Yeah.
And if you're selling the merchandise, you do have some responsibility for...
It seems cleaner behind the building than it used to be.
They used to dump stuff back
a little
there.
Bit.
They have a fence now that traps the trash.
Well, maybe
a filter.
For their purposes, that's not the worst thing. But.
Natalie, you had your hand
I
up.
Was just going to, my last comment would be not to underestimate the potential users from Osprey Landing and Spinnaker. And in addition to the, just, you know, the office and commercial spaces down Portsmouth Boulevard.
Well, I would imagine it isn't the office users that are walking their dogs in there.
Right.
No, yeah.
It's a good point.
Probably. And have you talked to Market Basket about that access through their back parking lot? Is that okay?
We will.
Okay.
I mean, we were talking to them about some other things out there. So I think we'll, now that we wanted to have this discussion to see if in fact, I mean, if you folks simply said, this is a terrible idea, don't do it, don't think about a bridge, you know, obviously you wouldn't be talking to them. So now it's sounding like this is more possible.
Yeah. And I like the idea of connecting to the sidewalks to go around that whole parcel of Market Basket in there, because the other side, I forget, Portsmouth, I mean, there's a sidewalk on that, and that goes along that wetland on the other side there, too.
Yeah, it's a nice loop. The whole thing would be a really nice loop.
Yeah, it would be a nice loop.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then at some point, I'd love to even explore the idea of, you know, we've talked about putting a little boardwalk, for lack of a better word, but out into those wetlands by Home Depot, just a little short boardwalk out to a circular platform in the middle of that wetland so people could sit out there and...
Yeah, it's nice out there.
It's nice out there. There's a lot of wildlife. It'd be a great place to sit.
Yeah.
But I like that circular, the connectivity and being able to, you know, and maybe that's part of the idea is maybe even just, you know, a little bit of signage with, you know, there's a 1 mile loop, a 2 mile loop, and a 3 mile loop or something. I don't know.
Sorry, Bob, where did you say you were from?
Sorry?
Where are you from?
Halverson Design, landscape architect.
Halverson Design. Okay, thank you.
Anything else to throw in there?
Okay, well, okay, thanks. Hey, good.
Thanks for the session.
Feedback, and I look forward to a sidewalk. So.
Well,
okay.
So we'll copy you three.
And Pete, or any other business?
I just have one thing. I got a call yesterday from Dave DeFosis, who heard about down at Prescott Park, the seawall. I guess there's a brick that's missing, and below the brick that's missing, like 5 feet down, it's just open. So there's some kind of sinkhole action happening on the inside, the Prescott Park side of the seawall. Uh-huh. So they're going to do a temporary fix, which is basically pull up all the asphalt in like a 150, 200 foot section. So if you're looking at, if you're at Pier 2, or you're looking at Pier 2 from the closest point you can get in the park, that parking lot that looks at Pier 2, you know, and then the pier that goes out. So the Pier 2 area on the land, not on the pier, but on the land, then there's a sheet pile bulkhead along the shore. And that behind that sheet pile bulkhead, there are sinkholes along the way. So they want to pull all that up, put a temporary fix with some concrete in to patch it, and then figure out a long-term solution in terms of rebuilding the seawall, because that's what's going to need to happen. They're undermining. So because it's in a previously developed shoreline and they're not changing the impervious surface, they can apply for a permit notification, but I wanted to let you guys know that it'll be coming, and we'll send it out like we normally do, but hoping to get it turned around quickly so they can do it so nobody gets sucked into the vortex.
No one drops into the hole.
Yeah.
Scary.
Yeah. They have it blocked off where the brick came out.
Uh-huh.
So you can't fall in there or get your leg stuck in there, but who knows where the next one's going to be. So they wanted us to do that whole section to make it safe and then put a permit in with some probably stone. I don't know how they're going to do it, but
yeah,
Duncan Miller or somebody, some marine engineer will look at it.
Okay.
That's all I really had, and I'm looking into, I'll report back more next meeting. I did a little research on the coal tar stuff and where they banned it around the country. And.
Well, I think we're also going
right.
To look at enabling legislation.
Our catch basins, do we do any testing?
And I talked to the, so the stormwater catch basins and the sewer manholes, when they need to, are pumped out and taken, the sediment is taken to a drying bed over the treatment plant. So the water comes off of that into the sewer treatment plant. Then they sample the sediment, and depending on what they find in it, they take it and dispose of it. And I haven't heard back from the plant on what they sample for, but I'll bring that information back.
Because I noticed
see if there's any PAHs.
Been a lot of pumping. The city trucks, I've seen them over on at various different places.
At catch basins, stormwater catch basins? Yeah, they're required to do it once a year, all the catch basins. So. But they can't just take that and dump it somewhere. They have to test it first, and then if it tests okay, they can put it different locations depending on what it comes back as.
So. Well, that's good to know.
Yeah, I'll have more detail on what the contaminants they sample for are and whether we find them. Because PAH is the concern with coal tar.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.
Did somebody announce that we're doing the Sagamore Creek thing on Thursday?
Oh. No. But Peter knows.
You just did.
We're doing the Sagamore Creek.
6 to 8.
Right?
The 21st.
21st. 6 to 8.
6
to 8. At the Urban Forestry Center.
Urban Forestry Center.
What are we doing?
So it's like a Sagamore Creek kind of open house sort of thing to learn about Sagamore Creek and how great it is and what kind of monitoring is being done and then potential planning efforts. And Peter's.
It's at the Urban Forestry?
Yep. Peter's
6
speaking.
To 8. Can you just email us?
Yeah, maybe.
Sure.
Maybe to everybody, just
that
in case.
That would be a good reminder.
Because yeah. Allison might not know, and she's on the
whole
creek.
Commission. Yep.
That's a Thursday night.
That's a good idea.
Yes.
What? I haven't really done any outreach for it, so that's a good idea.
Steve
although we're putting
and I
it on the website. I talked with the outreach person. They're going to put the poster up on the website, probably. And there's the press release went out, or is going out today or tomorrow or something. and there's a poster, and so I'll have something emailed to the commission, but we'll have something on the, probably on the banner, the poster will be closer.
They're going to have a section on Dockabilia.
Wait, what?
Docks on Sagamore Creek.
Dockville.
Oh.
Okay, thank you.
And if anyone knows a good place to put a poster, I have a couple posters left.
Those posters?
Yeah.
Sagamore Creek ones?
Yeah.
I don't think
we
there's one at
one
City Hall.
We have one in the library?
Well, I don't think there's one at City Hall either.
Nobody gave me one. I saw a couple at Public Works.
I got one in my car.
Wait a minute. I took six upstairs. And
put them.
I gave them to Isaac.
Oh.
And I stopped at the... I stopped at the front desk,
yeah,
and informed about putting up a poster,
but
and was told I couldn't.
We have not adjourned.
I know. I was told I could not do it, but I took six up here, then Isaac said he would take care of it.
You didn't ask the right person, I guess.
I obviously.
A motion to adjourn.
Second.
Seconded. All right.
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.